celebrating on Sunday. Ash Wednesday is actually this coming Wednesday, and it leads the 40 weekdays, actually 40 days up to Lent. It's every day except for Sunday. And so it's basically Monday through Saturday for the next 40 days. And it's a time where we remember what Jesus did and a time where we set aside something I'll talk about a little bit this morning. But if you want to grab your Bible to start this morning, or you can just look at the screen because it's already up there, we're going to turn to Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 20. And we're going to start with this verse this morning, and then we're going to talk about some things and then come around to Ash Wednesday. So stick with me, all right, because we're going to read this verse and then we're going to go somewhere else for a little bit. All right? Is that okay? It got real quiet up in here real quick. Is that okay? All right, it's all right. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 20. It says, all go to the same place. All come from dust, and to dust all return. I'll read it one more time. All go to the same place. All come from dust, and to dust all return. Let's pray this morning, and then we'll get started. God, I thank you for your word. I thank you for verses like this that we don't even quite understand sometimes. But I pray that even as I talk this morning, God, with the concepts you put on my heart, that I pray that you would give us the grace to hear what your Spirit is saying to us and the grace to remember to reflect on who you are and what you've done for our lives as we enter into this season, celebrating and leading up to Easter, God. I pray this morning that you would give us ears to hear what you have to say. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So I want to talk this morning for a few minutes about the idea of but God. All right now. Look at the person next to you and say, but God. I heard a concept when I was in high school that changed my life and definitely impacted my theology when I learned about what's called the butt line. Now, some of you guys are like, hold up, what are we in church this morning? The butt line, the last 2 weeks, you were talking about love and intimacy. This is getting a little, all those rumors I heard about God's house. Now, stick with me, B-U-T, butt line, all right? Because all throughout Scripture, as you begin to study the Bible and begin to understand who God is, if you take simple parts of the Bible and read just part of the verse, you can miss the whole concept. You can miss what God is trying to say, or you can build a theology on a doctrine that is so demeaning that you don't ever think you could have freedom living a life with Christ. And so there's this concept called the butt line, with verses such as we find in Romans chapter 3, a very common verse if you've been in church a long time. In Romans chapter 3, I believe it's in verse 6, it says, it's going to come up on the screen, isn't it? I think. Hold on, it's right here. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And if you hear that verse, you can get kind of depressed, right? What's the point? I can't measure up. All of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Some of you may have been raised in churches or raised in mindsets or theologies where this is all you were taught. You were taught that you are nothing. You were taught that you'll never measure up. You were taught that you fall short of God's glory. And so what's the point? But the but line inserted here in verse 24, the next verse says, but they are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Look how one little word changed the whole trajectory of where we would be without Christ. We can't measure up on our own, but because of the redemption of Christ, because he went to the cross, we now have access to God and we're forgiven of our sins. So I wonder in your life this morning, where has there been a but God for you? I was thinking through my life this week and kind of complaining to God. Anybody ever complain to God? Okay, you can admit it. Yeah. You know, about some stuff going on that I don't like what's going on and all these different things. And I was just like telling God my woes and telling him the things that he needs to fix and all these different things. And I just heard him say to me, but where were you 5 years ago? Where were you 10 years ago? You see, some of you this morning don't even realize that but God, you would be not be here today. Some of you were given reports 14 years ago that said you had 6 weeks to live, but you're sitting here breathing today and you're complaining about your aching back. Why don't you start giving God praise that you're alive anyway? Some of you are in marriages today that should have ended in divorce a long time ago, but God has continued. It may not have been easy, but he's continued to press through with you and continued to teach you to love in greater ways, and you're still here this morning. Now, some of you on the flip side got out of some marriages. Come on. Because I know some of you are going, oh, now I just feel condemned. Here's the deal. If you were in something that was so unhealthy that it was taking you away from God, I don't think but God. I'm not going there this morning. I'm not trying to teach anything. You know what I mean? If you're in a place where you are being abused or condemned or cheated on or lied to, that is not God. And see, sometimes we try to stick there because we're like, but God told me to. No. We serve a God who says, I want my best for you. I don't condone sin, but I sure do make a way when things are being pressed against you because I'm a God of justice. And when there's injustice in your life, but God, I'll show up and make a way. Some of you in this morning, you shouldn't even have the job you have, right? I was talking to Miss Amy over here yesterday about that. We both have jobs we don't deserve because we didn't have the education for them. We didn't have the trainings we should have got. But God, we are where we are. I wonder in your life, where is your but God in your life? And if you started focusing on what God has done, how would it change your mindset? You see, it's so easy for us to get stuck and say, we're right here, and it's just been really a hard year, and I'm preaching to myself this morning, all right? It's been a hard year, and things have been tough, and I had to work through this, and I had to change some things that I didn't want to change, and I had to work on things I didn't want to work on. But as I'm sitting the other day in my living room that's as big as my apartment I first had when I first got married, complaining to God that I don't know how I'm paying my bills, I felt like God was like, seriously, dude? You're living in a house that you shouldn't have been able to get. You're working in a ministry that people would love to work in. Now, I'm not saying not everyone's lined up to come serve an inner city ministry, but for me, this was my dream. And but God that I'm here today, because I didn't get the seminary degree. I didn't get all the trainings I needed, especially for this style of ministry. I did a lot of trainings in, you know, big churches and real, like, I don't know the word for it. Affluent churches, my wife says, but not even that. Like, you know, they didn't prepare you for stuff like roofs leaking. No one told me about that. No one said that you're going to want to preach the word on Sunday and clean toilets on Monday. That wasn't part of the trainings I went into. I'm going to write them a letter. I don't know what I paid for. You know what I mean? But God, I'm here where I know I'm called to be. Some of you have been in situations in your life where you're complaining so much. And God's like, if you would look at where you've come from, your entire perspective would change. Yes, there may be some things that you still need worked out. Yes, there may be some circumstances that still need to be turned around. Yes, there may be some stuff in your life that seems so off and so out of whack and so out of order right now that you're like, God, I don't know how this is ever going to work out, but God. Where has God come through in your life? Where has God said, if I didn't step in, you wouldn't be where you are? Without God, none of us would be where we are. And so this morning, what I want to challenge us as we're walking into talking about what is Ash Wednesday and what is the season of Lent and what does it mean to give up and what does it mean to focus on Christ, what I wanted to build the platform on this morning is it all starts with God. It all starts with God. Everything that you have, everything that you do, everything that you've done, if it were not for him, you wouldn't get to where you need to be. You wouldn't have what you need to have to do what he's called you to do. Without him, there is nothing. Jesus plus nothing equals everything. Jesus plus nothing equals everything. And I think sometimes as we're walking into seasons like Lent and seasons where we're going to celebrate Easter and we're going to remember the sacrifice that Jesus made, it's very easy for us to think, well, Jesus and my good looks. Right? Jesus and my credit card. Jesus and my dream career that I told God I had to have or I'm not going to serve him. Jesus and the agenda I gave God when I told him my 14 points and my 3 sub-points under each point of what I would do if he called me to do it, and I would only do it if XXXX happened. And then Jesus called me and I just showed up and didn't get anything answered, and now I got everything. Because Jesus plus nothing equals everything. We started this message with the verse that says, all are from dust, and to dust we return. It's a real encouraging way to start service, right? You're just a bunch of mud. Add a little water. Shoot, at God's house, it should be all our mud because we leak when it rains. So it's like the dust turns into mud. And to mud, we're going to return. Sorry, now my warped sense of humor is like, shoot, that's how you raise people from the dead. Right? The dust, it unsettles, and then the bodies come up. Anyways, okay. Maybe I just thought that was funny. Warped sense of humor, sorry. Okay, so, but all of us are dust. And if you don't know what dust is, then that can seem really demeaning. But God. Because see, here's what I believe about the dust that Ecclesiastes chapter 3 is talking about. In Genesis chapter 1, it talks about God creating the world. And he started by speaking into light, which, I mean, it's incredible that God just voiced, his voice activates light. Hello, you're in a dark place this morning and you're trying to figure out how to turn the light on in your life. Just let God speak. His voice activates light. That's crazy, right? And then he speaks in all the ground and he separates the ground from the sea and he looks at all of it and he says, this is good. Then he goes and he starts bringing in like animals, which he says is good. I could take or leave those ones, but like he says it's good. And he creates all these animals, and then he creates the fish of the sea, and he has all these things, this whole beautiful poetic writing of the story of creations in Genesis chapter 1. And after everything that he creates, he calls it good. And so when we talk about dust, the dust we talk about is good. Now, I don't know about you, but when you get your little Norwex cloth out, I learned what the Norwex was this year. If all y'all quit getting my wife into these Ponzi schemes. I'm just kidding. Oh, I got eyes, folks. I wish we had a camera that sat right here. She got it all for free, and I'm sure it's great. If you sell, I'm not condemning anybody. We have everything is Norwex. You can come to our house and test it out if you want, because she did a party. Anyways. I love you. Ooh. So, but you get your little, you know, dust rag out, and your house is all dusty, and if you're like us, a lot of our furniture is dark, you know, that dark wood, and when you see it, you're like, oh, that's so pretty, and then you have it for like 2 weeks, and you're like, oh my gosh, that's disgusting, because there's just dust everywhere, right? Like, we should have bought everything like light colors, because it wouldn't show dust, and so you get your dust rag, and you're dusting away everything in your house. Your typical thought as you're dusting is that this is not good, right? How many here dust their house thinking, this is so awesome, thank you, Lord, for dust? I just thank you for creating all this dust that's ruining everything, right? But when God created the earth, he looked at the earth, and then he said, it is good. Then later on in Genesis chapter 1, he creates humanity out of the dust of the ground. Now we're going somewhere. Because that same dust that annoys you, that same dust that gets everywhere, that same dust that makes you sneeze and have to take Claritin, all that dust is good dust, and that dust is what you were created from, and that dust is where you're going to when you die. Right? He took us out of the ground and created us out of dust. And so from dust we came, and to dust we return, but the dust he created us out of was already called good before he created you. He called you good before he created you. What? But see, if you don't know the but God and you don't know the but line, You don't believe that. You're like, I can't be good because the wages of sin is death, right? True. But the gift of God in Christ Jesus is the redemption for you and makes you good. And so the whole point of the cross was that when God created humanity, when God created the world, when humanity was in the garden, they had this relationship with God where they could commune with God and they could talk with God and they could be in relationship with God. In fact, after Adam and Eve sinned, after they fell away from God, it says that's the first time they experienced shame. Isn't it interesting? You were not created to experience shame. Shame came from sin. So if you're feeling shame anywhere in your life and you feel like God has been the one trying to shame you, that's a lie. God doesn't bring shame on you. He may bring conviction on you when you're doing something out of line and try to pull you back in, but God will never shame you. Shame came as a result of sin. Before that, God looked at the dust of the ground and called it good. Then he looked at the humanity he created and called it good. And the whole intent of the cross was God trying to reconcile us back to the moment where he created us as good. We came from dust. We go to dust. But God doesn't look at that dust and think, let me just blow that out of here. God looks at that dust and says, I chose to create you out of that dust because I wanted relationship and companionship with you. And then when we go along and we messed it up, and I always, you know, we like to judge Adam and Eve and they messed it all up, and I think they get a lot of flack, you know what I mean? Because I don't know about you, but I'd have messed it up. It wouldn't have been over an apple, I'll tell you that. I wish that was my worst sin. Lord, I would have been some Applebee's. What is that called? Honey barbecue wings. And some spinach and artichoke dip with more salt than you can handle in a lifetime in one meal. It's amazing. Just that, You got to drink like 3 gallons of water to get it down. That's what it would have been for me. I'm just being real. But I would have messed it up, right? You would have messed it up. I hate to break it to you. Because without God, we're not anything. Because Jesus plus nothing equals everything. So me with Jesus gives me access to everything, but me without him is nothing. We would have messed it up just like he did. And so the whole point of the Easter season and what God is trying to do in reconciling us back to himself through Christ is to say, look, I created you good. I called you good before you were even made. I had a relationship with you where you felt no shame until you experienced shame. And now I want to reconcile you back to myself. And the only way I know to do that is by giving my son, who's fully me and fully you, up as a sacrifice so you can live. That's the Easter season we're walking into. And what's beautiful is that, with that as Christians, is guys, that's where we start our life. I think a lot of us had this idea in mind that salvation and giving our lives to Christ is where we end, right? As long as I say that sinner's prayer before I die, I'm okay. Right? Anybody else grow up like that? Got to just say that prayer, those 14 words in that one prayer. I don't know how many words it is, but you know what I mean? Like this one little prayer, and if I say that prayer, I'm all good, and I'm going to go to heaven when I die. Jesus said, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Salvation is not the exit. Salvation is the entry point to a life with Christ. God is not waiting for you to die. The problem when we say that the wages of sin is death, we think, well, that's what it is. I'm a mess. I'm all messed up. And God's just waiting for me to die so he can deal with me. No, the gift of God is eternal life. And eternal life is already begun the minute you meet Christ. He already calls you good again. The minute you come into relationship with him, it's not for someday way out there when we all get to heaven. Heaven comes to earth when Christ comes to you. He lives inside of you. His kingdom has come when you receive his grace. And so Easter is not the time of year that we come and we kind of get, oh God, we're so sorry, and we do all this, but we're just going to keep tarrying on until you come or we die. And we know that you want us to die, God, and that's the whole point. You created us so we would die. Anybody else have that mindset for a long time? I remember the first time I heard someone preach on the butt line. I thought, what is the butt line? This church is getting crazy. And he read that verse out of Romans, one simple verse, and I went, whoa. Because I had thought over and over and over that my sin and my mess and my mistakes could never be reconciled until I died. As long as on my deathbed, I said, Jesus, please forgive me. But when you understand that the but line is inserted and he says, but the gift of God is eternal life. And you receive that eternal life the minute you receive Christ and you start the adventure of following him and building his kingdom. That's the season we're walking into. And I don't know about you, but I'm kind of excited about it this year. I decided that if I'm going to be a Christian, I might as well embrace Christianity. I mean, we all go through seasons, right? We all go through times in our life, and I'm 31 now, so I'm back to the part where I actually think my parents are really smart people, you know? Like, you go through that thing where your parents are idiots, and they don't know a thing in the world, and you go through the church is just the scum of the earth, and you go through all these different seasons, and then you get to the point, and you're like, do I really believe this? Like, why am I here, right? Like, not why am I here in life, that's a way bigger question, but like, why am I here in church today, right? What's the point of me being here if I'm going to say that I don't really embrace Christianity? And so I decided this year I'm just embracing it. We're just going to embrace it as a church. We're going to embrace the fullness of the death of Jesus. The whole month of April, we're going to do a series called It Is Finished, and we're going to talk about the power of Christ and his death on the cross and what it means for our lives. Not so we can all sit around and go, oh God, I wish I'd been on the one on the cross, I'm so sorry. No, so we can understand the fullness that he gave us in laying his life down so we could have access to the kingdom of God. How incredible is that? We don't have to live these mundane, little, sluggish lives like, oh, it's so hard to be a Christian. It's just terrible. And, oh, you got to sacrifice. And no, it's a joy. The Bible says that for the joy set before him, Jesus endured the cross. I don't even endure traffic. I don't endure long lines at Starbucks, for crying out loud. For the joy set before him, he endured laying down his life for me so I could have access to a joy-filled life. That's the God that we're celebrating this Easter. So as I wrap up this morning, we're going to close a little differently today. And I'm going to go through a few things and just kind of give you guys some ideas of what is Ash Wednesday. If you didn't grow up in a more traditional church, you may not know what Ash Wednesday is and what the Lent season is. And this is not to put legalism on anybody. If you don't want to embrace this, you don't have to. You're still welcome to come. No one's going to be checking in to make sure that you're giving something up for Lent. All right? That's not what we're doing. But this is giving you an invitation to say for the next 6 weeks, what can I do to show God that he's first in my life? In John chapter 3, there's a verse that says, God must increase and I must decrease. And Lent is a season where we say to God, I want you to increase in my life, so I'm going to choose to give something up for the next 40 days so that I can focus on my relationship with you to thank you for enduring the cross for me. I'll read you just kind of an example of what Ash Wednesday is. It says, Ash Wednesday marks the beginning of Lent. Lent is a season of 40 days, not counting Sundays, which begins on Ash Wednesday, which is this coming Wednesday, and ends on the Saturday before Easter. Lent comes from the word lenten, which means spring. The 40 days represents the time Jesus spent in the wilderness, enduring the temptation of Satan and preparing to begin his ministry. What's really cool about taking 40 days before Easter and preparing for Easter is what? Where we begin, not where we end. A lot of church calendars try to make Easter the climax of the year, and that's like the greatest service they ever do, and they pull out the worship band for that day, you know, and they pull out the lights, and they're like, we're going to make this the biggest deal of the year. Yes, you do prepare for more people to come because Christers come, Christmas and Easter, that's what happens, but like, that's just the beginning. When we leave here on Easter, it's not like, oh man, now we can relax till next year and we got to talk about Jesus again. No, we leave here on Easter so the adventure begins for us to change our community because of what Jesus did. And so this time preparing for it is a time we set aside and say, God, I want to be ready to make you as big as I can possibly make you. Because I know that without you, I would have nothing. But God, I'm here even today. I know that without you, there'd be no reason for me to live. And so it's a time where we can fast something and prepare for the coming of Easter. It's a time where we can repent. It's a time where we can lament. It's a time where we can say, look at ourselves with self-examination and reflection. In the early church, Lent was a time to prepare new converts even for baptism. Today, we as Christians focus on our relationship with God during the time, often choosing to give up something or volunteer or give of ourselves for others. And so what we're going to challenge you to do today is, will you take the next 40 days? Here's the thing, you get Sundays off. How great is that? I mean, like, here's the thing with Lent. You don't have to, I was telling our leaders this morning, it's not always just giving something up. Sometimes it's adding something in, all right? Sometimes it's saying, God, I'm going to spend an hour with you today. And I'm going to replace an hour that I usually serve Facebook, and I'm going to spend that hour reading my Bible and praying, right? Sometimes it's saying, God, I'm going to choose for the next 40 days that every day I'm going to go out of my way to do some kind of random act for somebody and just show kindness to the world. Maybe for you it is, I'm going to fast. I'm not going to eat during this time, or I'm going to fast sweets or whatever that is. But you're saying for 6 days a week, for the next 6 weeks, that's a big commitment, right? If any of you guys joined us in January for the Daniel fast, 21 days was long. 40 is even longer. I'm telling you, this is getting hard this year. No, it's a joy to get to do it because it's saying, God, I know without you, I'm nothing. So what can I do to prepare myself for the year ahead of me, the Easter that is coming, when we celebrate what you did on the cross? What can I do for myself? And so part of the tradition of Lent is the starting with Ash Wednesday. And so before you leave here today, our elders and Kelsey and I are going to invite you to come forward, and we're going to take some ash. What's interesting about ash and interesting about dust, right? From dust we came, from dust we return. What is ash? It's just dust, right? And the interesting thing about the ash we use for Ash Wednesday is this is actually ash left over from palm branches from last year's Palm Sunday. So on Palm Sunday, we celebrate Jesus coming in, and then those palms are saved throughout the year. Not our actual, we didn't like save them here. Just to clarify, we don't have like a palm closet. But you rebuy them. It's a great marketing ploy for Christian bookstores. You rebuy them. I'm sorry. I just stopped. Okay. So you rebuy them and they're just soot, which is interesting because there was life in the palm, right? And now it's dead. And it's the reminder that Jesus had life, and because of his death, he reconciled us back to God, and now we have life. But it's also a reminder to us that, guys, life is short. We're not promised tomorrow. I'm not trying to be morbid, but we're not promised tomorrow. And if we don't recognize our need for a Savior in our life, how are we ever, if we can't recognize him for 40 days, how are we going to recognize him with our life in a way that builds his kingdom on the earth? And so as we get ready to close this morning, a couple things you can write down will come up on the screen about what today Ash Wednesday, celebrating it on Sunday, is. It's first off a reminder that we are human. Ash Wednesday is a reminder that we are human. Sometimes we don't like to remind ourselves that we're human, right? At least I don't. I like to think that I'm God, right? I like to think I can tell him what I need, when I need it, and how I should get it. But this symbol of the cross is reminding us, no, I'm surrendering my life to something greater and saying, God, you are God, and without you, I'm nothing. I'm dust. And yes, it's good dust, and yes, it's holy, and yes, your creation was beautiful, and what you called me was good before I even was made. It's all beautiful, but I'm human, and I'm fully human, and I can embrace my humanness because I'm not God, which really takes the pressure off. You don't have to figure it all out because you're not God. The second thing to write down is that it's a remembrance that Christ, actually there's one more. Can we go back one on that? Sorry. I think it's a recalling. Yeah, here we go. Thank you. A recognition that God holds our world in his hands. From the beginning of time when he spoke with his mouth and created light, when he called it good, when he created all of us with the intention of companionship and intention of loving us and having relationship with us, from the moment he created humanity and the earth, he holds it in the palm of his hands. That sure makes my problems feel a whole lot less when I know that God holds my world in the palm of his hands. The last one that you can write down is that it's a recognition, a remembrance, that Christ alone holds the keys to the kingdom, both in life and in death. Christ holds the king, the keys. And so this act of putting a cross on your forehead is not anything special, but it's a reminder to you of what Jesus did for you, and saying that for the next 40 days, I'm going to do something in my life to thank God for the but God moments in my life. I'm going to do something in my life to recognize that I'm human, to remember what he did on the cross, to remember that he holds the world, the whole world in his hands. And I'm going to do this as an act of my faith in God, knowing that without Jesus, I'm nothing. And so this cross, you can keep it on your head all day, or you can wash it off when you leave. It doesn't really matter. But if you want to keep it on your head and someone says to you, especially on Sunday, because most churches will do it on Wednesday. So if you go out to eat after and someone goes, what is the soot on your head? Right? You just say, this is my reminder that I'm human. This is my reminder that without God, I wouldn't be here today. This is my reminder that through this season of Lent, I'm recognizing that I have a need for a Savior. And I'm going to give my life continually for him. So I'm going to invite you to stand with us this morning. If you want to start with us on Wednesday, we're going to be posting devotionals online every day on Facebook. You can go to the God's House Marian Facebook, and there will be a Lent devotional for you to read each day of Lent. That's a lot of devotionals, 40 of them. Just something to encourage your day as you're getting ready for it. The next couple days, I'm not saying, you know, do what you want to do, like go, you know. But if you're getting ready to fast, especially if you're going to fast, you know, the next couple days, hey, I told leaders this morning to go get a punchki, but no one knew what a punchki was. Anybody know what a punchki is? Where's all the Michigan people at? Apparently it's a Michigan thing. I'm sorry, look, there's like three people in this room knew what a punchki was. It's a donut that you eat on Fat Tuesday that's like 1,000 calories that changes your whole life. It takes 40 days to lose the weight from that one donut. And no one in Indiana knows what it is. So next year, I'm not doing it. Maybe next year we'll drive to Michigan the day before or something and we'll sell them. We're healthier here in Indiana. But I know how to turn the donut industry around in Marion is all I got to say. If they're struggling, they wouldn't be anymore if they get some punchkis. But go get yourself a Cinnabon. Oh, Jesus. Something. Before you start giving up those sweets, I don't know what you're going to do. And we laugh about it, and it's fun. And you know, that's the thing. It doesn't have to be all somber all the time, right? A time of reflecting on God does not have to be morbid and all somber. There's times where you realize, you know, again, giving up and trying to make God increase. But there's joy in it as well, that God, I get to do this. You get to do this. And so what we're going to do this morning is we're actually going to put these crosses on your head. I'm going to invite Herschel, if you can take that table over there, and Dave and Rhonda, if you can hit that one over there, and Kels, we'll stand here in the middle. And as we leave, we'll confess the blessing in just a minute. As we leave, sorry, I just nominated you, don't mind. As we leave this morning, we just want to invite you to come forward, and we'll put a cross on your forehead as a reminder of what you're committing to over the next few weeks, all right? So let's pray this morning, and then we'll get out of here. God, I thank you for what Jesus means to each of us. I pray this morning, God, that if anyone here under the sound of my voice has never given their life to you, that today would be the day that they say, God, I'm going to give up my own cause and I'm going to try this living for Jesus thing. I'm going to say that I recognize that I'm human, but that you love me so much that you came into the world fully God and fully man fully part of the dust and fully part of the Godhead because you loved me so much. Pray this morning, God, that anyone here who's never just opened their heart to you, God, it's not a formula, it's not a special prayer, it's just a surrender of saying, Jesus, thank you. I receive your love for me. I receive your love for me. I give up my way and I submit to your way. I lay down the weights that have entangled me. I lay down my mess. I lay down my sin and I say, I don't want all that anymore, God. I want more of you. And I pray today for all of us here, God, that through this season of Lent, as we remember, we reflect on who you are, we recognize our need for a Savior, we remember that we're human, we remember that you hold the keys of life and death. I pray that in this season, you would increase and we would decrease, God. That in this season, that you would speak to us as we do times of fasting or giving up or spending more time with you or whatever we choose to do, God, that you would speak to us and prepare our hearts for what's ahead with Easter coming, God. That you would prepare us for a celebration like we've never had before that starts our year and doesn't end it, God. A celebration that says, because you live, I live. And because you live and you've called me to build your kingdom, I'm now a kingdom builder and I can go out to the world around me spreading your love and spreading your joy. And so as we leave here today, I pray that you'd remind us of who you are to us, that we'd lay our lives down for you, that we would decrease and you would increase, and that as we celebrate this Lent season, God, you would be so near to us. And I thank you for it. In Jesus' name. After you get the cross this morning on your head, if you need prayer for anything, I'll ask our prayer partners to stand down here as well. If you want to give your life to Christ, maybe you never have, they'd love to pray with you. If you are your first time here on your way out, you can stop at our Connect desk. We'd love to get to know you. Don't forget those of you that are interested in becoming partners of our church. Partnership is immediately following service back in the cafe. And also on your way out today, if you could sign those cards if you didn't get a chance to for the teachers at Riverview. We're just getting ready to bless them tomorrow with some care packages. It's going to be awesome, so we appreciate that as well. Before we go, let's confess the blessing over ourselves and our week, and then you can be dismissed to come forward and get the cross on your head as we go. Let's say this together. My best and most blessed days are ahead of me. Love you guys. Hope to see you back next week.